If you know anything of Jamaican history, you must know about the Maroons. Well, today we're going to talk with some Maroons up in the Maroon settlement of Accompong. So don't go anywhere. Carib Nation is up next. Welcome to Carib Nation. I'm David Hines, up here in Maroon country, in particular the Accompong Maroon settlement. Our conversation today will be with the chief and members of his council up here in this settlement. Oh, gentlemen, brethren, welcome to Carib Nation. Welcome. Let me start with you first, chief. When one talks about Maroons, what is the first thing that must come to mind?
The first thing that must come to mind is their victory over the British, which resulted in a treaty that was signed in 1738, because they were no match to us, and because of that, a treaty was signed, and we were given lands as compensation and certain amount of freedom, which have existed even till now.
And of course, the whole question of resistance is important, because you resisted against the British, you resisted against oppression, you refused to be subjected.
Yes, so we are very proud of that, to know that we got freedom long before emancipation because of our bravery and the fight that we put up, because we actually are children of slaves. We came from Africa. We are mostly of the Ashanti tribe, the Karamanti tribe, Igbos, and such like, but we banded together and fought the British and won the war.
300 years and 300 and more years later, here is this compound, here is this community still very much in existence, still called a Maroon settlement. How have you been able to maintain all of this over these years?
Well, we try to teach our children the culture and remind them that they can be great, and we stick to our heritage, and we intend to carry on as Maroons, free Maroons, as long as the world exists.
And of course, you have your organization. You're here with members of the council. Let me let you just walk through and tell us who these members are and the function of the council members.
Yeah, well, I was elected colonel in October 1998. Uh-huh. I have a council. It's 21 members in it. You have two deputies, secretary, assistant secretary, treasurer, assistant treasurer, and this is Mr. Foster, my security chief. Mm-hmm. This is my brother. He's a member of the council as well. He's the chief instrument player when we have our traditional music on the 6th of January, which it's traditional and it's celebrated each year.
Mm-hmm. And the gentleman over there?
He is the Minister of Culture and Agriculture as well. So he is well in the middle of things.
And this gentleman here?
He is a tour guide and he's also a member of the council.
So each council member has his own function to carry out.
Yes.
Are there women on the council?
There are women on the council, but not on the spot at the moment. But there are five women involved in the council.
Okay, let me talk to the Minister of Agriculture. What's your function?
Well, my role is to see that the farmer get on with them crops. And whenever time crops are ready, you see market for them. Yeah.
All right. And you are the man who look after the instrument, play the drums and all that kind of stuff. But you obviously look quite young. Oh, compared with the other gentleman here. Tell us how you got involved in this thing and rise to the point of a council member.
Yeah, well, I got to be a council member, so I play the instrument, the gumbe. First, the elder man we used to play it. I used to go around the playground when the function is performing and watch the man who played. So I eventually, when that man died, I have to take over
Okay, so
continue.
It's a generation thing.
Yeah, hand down from one generation to the next one.
Okay, let me talk to the security man here, because obviously the whole question of the military composition of the settlement seems to be very much in place today. So there's still need for security. What do you do as the man responsible for security?
My chief motive is my second terms as a minister of security. I serve capacity in past criminal rights government as 20 years as a security. And from then, I'm still working with the council. And since the officials launched out of this newly Colonel Petty, I was elected again as a security. And my chief aim as a security committee is to maintain laws and order. Mm-hmm. And whenever time not anything, any outbreak in the community, then I notify. Mm-hmm. And whatsoever that I cannot afford to do, then I contact the outdoor government for an assistant.
I see.
Yes.
I see. Mm-hmm. You're the tour guide. You're the man that when they come in and they want to look around and see and so on, you carry them around and so on. How challenging you find that?
Well, I find it very good to have been teaching someone about my history and my heritage and about my people, because, you know, we are a freed nation living in Jamaica, African nation, so it feel real gracious to have people to learn more about this.
Mm-hmm. Let me come back to you, Cornell, and let's talk about maintaining the culture and maintaining the spirit, because obviously we live in a world that has changed a lot from since back in the days 300 years ago, 250 years ago. How is it that in the face of what they call, they got a big word that's called modernization,
yes,
in the face of all this big modernization, how you are able to keep this thing together?
Well, we have our annual celebration on the 6th of January each year, visited by people from almost every country in the world. But how we maintain the culture and heritage is by teaching the young. We try to tell them as early as possible that they can be great. We learn them our songs, tell them about our history, tell them about the traditional foods that we used to cook, our ancestors used to cook, and then we keep it that way. So when they grow up, they just fall in line and we carry on.
So the question of educating the young people is extremely,
exactly,
extremely important.
Exactly.
And how are you, well, I know the culture you say is one way of keeping them out, keeping Babylon out, yeah?
Yes.
And making sure that the purity of the thing continue. But how else you keep out all this Babylon, I'm sure, coming knocking at the gate and so on? How are you able to keep the thing together and keep them out?
Well, they're a well-disciplined race. I would call them race these days. Well-behaved. Mm-hmm. And we don't have any much trouble here. Just domestic squabbles which can be settled by the colonel, because I am a kind of a peace officer, so to speak. Mm. So anything that seems to be getting out of hand, the colonel would call a meeting and then decide on the spot what should be done. Mm-hmm. And because of that, now we can avoid the courts outside.
So you kind of settle your own matters here. You have your own justice system and so on.
Exactly.
No, you seem to have what, again, another big word, but I got to use it.
Mm-hmm.
A democratic system, fair play, because you have a council and you make your decisions and so on. Is this something that was handed down from the days when you were fighting and so on?
Yes, handed down, because once upon a time we used to try our own cases here and meet out our own punishment as well. But these days, we don't see where that is necessary, because the children that we have these days are well-behaved.
Okay.
And I would tell you that since 1738, when the treaty was signed, we have had only one murder committed in Accompong since 1738. And I think that's...
That's fantastic.
Yes.
That's something that the world must know about.
Yes.
I mean, before I come here, I would not have imagined that. I guess your chief economic activity, how people make their living and so on, a lot of farming.
Farming.
Okay, exactly. Let me tell the agriculture man talk about it, because I suppose that you farm so that you can get food to eat, but you also do trade with, sell your food and so on. Talk a little bit about that.
Well, we up here as Maroon, mostly are pure farmers. And then whenever time we farm, we try to look market, people from others come in, come by. And what really happened is that we need more from the outgoing government to assist us, because we are a poor nation. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we are a poor nation, because if you check it out today, majority of all we see is just farming the map to live off of. Mm-hmm. And then we don't get any help from no other source away from farming. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Let me talk a little bit about the culture, yeah? Because the culture is important. Quite apart from talking English, well, what they call the Queen's English and so on, do you all talk like African language? Do you have your own dialect here and so on?
Yeah, we used to have our own language, but most of the old ahead die. Uh-huh. And they never really teach the younger one the language, like a charismatic language. But we learn a part of the songs, uh-huh. The charismatic songs. Say for instance, someone die and you dig in a grave. You have certain song where you sing and pour the overproof white rum, and the ancestor will help. If a stone is hard to come out of the grave, the ancestor's spirit come and help.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And like how a fellow Africans, we come here to visit. You got any song or ritual that you do and so on?
Oh yes.
Well, let me get a piece. Go right ahead. Go straight in.
Song. Uh-huh. Well, this song, like when you dig in a grave.
No, like a visitor coming.
A visitor.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Oh. Like this song now. Audio, 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 me fumble. Audio, 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 me fumble. Audio, 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 me fumble. That mean now is one family.
Family.
Yeah.
And you know I come from Guyana, yeah? And we say family. Mm-hmm. So when you say so, yeah. I know what you mean. The African thing all the way. We come from the same ship.
Same ship.
Let me bring you guys in, yeah? So that we all get a piece of the thing. Now, when you going around and carrying people to see the Maroon thing and so on, and tell them the history, what is the part that you stress the most to them outsiders?
Well, we stress the most about the cave which the English get, the ambush trap they set up for the English, and also the ambush tactics. Like, there's a way how we can still do a camouflage happening for them. Like, we would wrap someone up who's going with us on a trail in the green bush and tell him or her to come out and let them have a view of how the English get trapped.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
No. And you reenact this in play form and so on and that kind of thing. Yes, go ahead. You want to say something?
No, not as yet.
Not as yet. You take your time. Well, look, let's talk about this whole story, because when we talk about the Maroon, it's about you fight these people and you force them to sign a treaty through fighting. Tell us about the story. You know, how it all gets started and how it all wrap up.
Well, the main reason why we become the most important Maroon settlement in Jamaica is simply because the cave where the treaty was signed is here.
Uh-huh.
And Kodjo, our great leader,
right,
used to live here as well. He mm-hmm. died and buried here. So it all started by, in Clarendon, a parish in the east, there was at Sutton's farm, mm-hmm. some slaves got away, they rebelled and got away, but the very following day, they were captured and executed. Mm-hmm. But five members of the rebellious slaves went into the hills of Clarendon. And then they start to set up their camps and so in the cockpit country. That's where we actually are, in the cockpit country at the moment. So they used to recruit each others, and then slaves start to join them till they have an army. Mm-hmm. And then they start to fight the British that way. They brought in dogs, they brought in everything, but they find them, there was no match for the Maroons because they were better equipped.
Ah, better equipped. Yes. What was the secret? What made them better equipped? Was it that you know the terrain? Was it that you were special fighting spirit? Eh?
Yes. The terrain was too rough for the English soldiers. And, you know, being an African, we are accustomed to the rough terrain.
And then again, there was a woman there called Nani.
She was
a sister to Kodro, and she used to fight with... She had supernatural powers.
Mm-hmm.
So she could read in advance what the British were up to.
Uh-huh.
So history have it that she could even turn her buttocks and catch bullets and send it back with devastating effect.
Okay.
So there were no match for the Maroons.
So it was a combination of the terrain, a combination of the culture that you bring across from Africa.
And the scientific and
exactly.
That's what they used.
Right. I got to ask you all this question. If I didn't ask you this question, I would not be honest. Mm-hmm. I read in the books that the Maroons used to catch slaves who run away and carry them back to the Timaso. Talk a little bit about that.
That was after the treaty was signed. There was a treaty signed as such with us that we should assist them in certain ways, the government outside, the colonial powers then.
Right.
And it was such that was in the clause as well.
Okay.
It was even in the clause that if Jamaica was invaded in any form of sort, they should come to the Maroons and get the Maroons to assist them to beat off anybody that tried to attack Jamaica at the time.
But,
because
the
Maroons were such great fighters.
Uh-huh. But you're looking back at it now, I mean, 200, 300 years later, would you say that you might have done it a little bit differently if you had to do it all over again? In terms of catching the runaways, they put in that clause in?
Yes, I think it would be a bit different.
I think
it would be a bit different. I think there were some mistakes made in setting up the treaty, really. So if it should happen that we have to do it all over again, there would be some slight changes, I think.
Let's talk a little. Yeah, go ahead. You ready to come in now?
Oh, yes. What is the chief motive you want from me now? What is the chief point that you learned that I meant to speak on?
The same thing about the treaty.
Oh. Mm-hmm. As Colonel has suggested that the signing of this treaty in 1738-39, we were so fortunate. Our ancestor had been defeated in this man. Mm-hmm. As I suggest what about the because where he came from, Africa, came to Jamaica. He came here and ship trade. Was to work in the sugar plantation near the state in the northwest. Clarendon.
Clarendon, right.
Going to be Sutton.
And that's where the whole thing starts.
Yes.
I see. You mentioned at the beginning the different tribes, the Coromandel tribe, the Ashanti tribe, that's the fighting tribe and so on. And you have all these different tribes living in the compound and so on. Were there problems? Do you today still have problems? Who were Coromandel, who were Ashanti and so on?
No,
none of that?
No, we see ourselves as one family.
Uh-huh.
Because during, just when the war was formulated, we all agreed to fight together as one.
Mm-hmm.
So we forget about the tribal aspects completely and fought as one black people fighting the common enemy.
Okay. So no tribal differences
and
all that kind of thing.
No.
Now I commented on the point when we first begin that they ain't got no women here, but you did say that women are part
of
the council and so on. And you know, and you mentioned the role that Nani played.
Yes.
And so on. Do women continue, not just to sit on the council, but do they continue to play an active role in the community?
Yes, still dominant in certain quarters.
Uh-huh.
I think they get that fighting spirit from Nani, really. But there are women here at the moment that have that same spirit that Nani had.
Let's talk. Go ahead, Colonel.
I don't know if I'm saying it too late, but the thing is that slavery started under the Spaniards.
Right.
And the first shipload of slaves came in about 1515.
Mm-hmm.
Well, after when the British invaded Jamaica in 1655. They took over, and then the slave trade was intensified under the British.
Right.
But it really started under the Spaniards.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes, yes. Well, Mr. Cultureman, let me bring you in again. When you fight and you win a victory, you got to celebrate.
Yes.
And so you obviously get celebratory songs mm-hmm. that you sing. Yeah. Give me a celebratory tune.
Maroon la wolo, maroon la wola radio, lantaiko wolo, la wolo, la wolo, la wolo, maroon la wolo, maroon la wola radio, lantaiko wolo, la wolo, la wola radio, kongimi minota hale, lantaiko wolo, la wolo. Maroon la wolo, maroon la wola radio, lantaiko wolo, la wolo.
Interpretation.
Yeah, that was a
one point that I want to make clear. Uh-huh. We are the oldest Maroon in the history.
Uh-huh.
But there's one point of clarification. You heard about those Maroon were captured.
Uh-huh.
And go on slave trips
uh-huh.
to Nova Scotia.
Uh-huh.
Two of those men was from this said district. One was named George White, and the other named George Fowler.
Mm-hmm.
They were not in the rebellion against this with the St. James Maroon. So if they went to the government outside, invite them to a feast at Montego Bay. Come and celebrate with them. After we went to Montego Bay and that feast, they took them on ships.
Mm-hmm.
And they were migrated to Nova Scotia.
To Nova Scotia.
When they reached Nova Scotia, this man White and this man Fowler, they was in the rebellion. So those two men returned back to this said Maroon Town settlement. Now, those people that were on this ship trade, they were the sets of people that up till this crisis, they are in Nova Scotia, the descendant of the said Maroons.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they are here today, and they were transferred to other countries in the world, Europe, Asia, South Africa, mm-hmm. New Zealand, and all those countries
mm-hmm.
from this said Maroon, St. James.
Accompong.
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 Easy walking day, walking a yard. Easy walking day, oh, walking a yard. Easy walking day, make we walking a yard. Easy walking day, oh, walking a yard. Walking day, make we walk in a yard. Easy walking day, oh, walk in a yard. Oh, easy walking day, make we walk in a yard. Walking day, walk in a yard. Oh, easy walking day, make we walk in a yard. Oh, easy walking day, oh, walk in a yard. Walking day, walk in a yard. Oh, easy walking day, oh, walk in a yard. Easy walking day, walk in a yard. Oh, easy walking day, oh, walk in a yard.
And of course, when you're singing, you're doing the dance.
Yes.
Yeah, well, look, I can tell you this program gonna be watched or is being watched by people, Jamaicans and Trinidadians and Caribbean people and American people who live in North America.
Yeah.
Is there any particular message that you want to tell them? You know, something to tell them that the Maroons are still here, still surviving, still having the same fighting spirit?
Yes, the Maroons are still here. We have been here since 1738, so to speak.
Uh-huh.
And we have to be on our own with almost everything. We don't get any assistance from alternative governments, whether PNP or JLP, we have to fend on our own at all times. We live by farming, and then having no roads, that hampers the farming as well. Mm-hmm. So we can't get our produce in or out, so we are at a loss. The only assistance that we get up here from the government is that they pay the teachers in the school.
Okay.
Other than that, nothing.
And so this is an appeal, not just to the government, but also to
the world.
To the world.
Yes.
You need assistance after all that the Maroon did.
Yes.
For liberation in this part of the world.
They are marginalized, rejected, and forgotten.
And forgotten. And this program is really a cry.
A cry out, yes.
A cry out.
Yes.
A cry out, a cry out.
Yes.
All right. Look, before we go, we got to get a little bit more of the culture, a little bit more of the music. When you parting and you're going, song for part.
Yes.
Song for go.
Play anything.
This a town and no easy to know. Oh, don't know the call. Last one, no. Oh, don't know the call. Oh, don't do the call, last one, no. Oh, don't do the call. It's a town and no easy to know. Oh, don't do the call, last one, no. Oh, don't do the call. But we will live fully, oh, alone. We will live fully, oh, I hope you will alone. Night and day we in our row. We will live fully, oh, Edo. Edo, Edo, night and day we in our own. We will live poly on. We will live poly on alone. We will live poly on. I hope you will on. Night and day we in our own. We will live poly on. G plus O, then say I'm here. A glass O, then say I'm here. So then say I'm here. But yo, you know, see where country turn down for me poor Ramsey. We go ya because of the mo. We go ya because of nigga moto. We go ya because of the mo. But yo, you know, see where country turn down for me poor Ramsey.
As you would imagine, all the songs depicts the ill treatment that we have been through under the colonial powers. Mm-hmm. Because they were the strongest those days, and we were at their mercy. So we were badly treated. And as I mentioned before, we got lands as compensation for winning the war. Mm-hmm. But since we got the land, we have lost some. They stole back some of the land.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
They have changed the markings, changed the boundaries, and things like that. And you know it's a sin to change your neighbor's landmark.
Exactly. So in a sense, the struggle continues.
Yeah, the struggle continues.
The struggle continues.
Because we are complaining even now about lands that was taken away from us.
Chief of the Accompong Maroon compound and members of his council, thank you all very much for sharing your insights and sharing your culture and sharing your thoughts with us on Carib Nation. Well, there you have it. Maroons in Maroon country, telling their own story, making their own plea. I hope that you would have been educated and that you will respond. Until the next time, this is David Hines, thanking you for tuning in to yet another edition of Carib Nation. And remember, as always, our motto here is one people, one culture, one Caribbean, one nation.